So please welcome to the stage Anna Scar, Nathan Newman, Rhiann Roberts and Harry Pearson.
Thank you very much. It's lovely to be here. So, New Theatre of the Mind 2017, the year of virtual reality, apparently, is going to let us time travel into the past to explore, let's call them new experiences, to change our working lives and our media choices. That's if you believe the hype. So, as the custodians of the first mass medium, what does the radio industry need to know about VR? And how are we, as radio people, leading the way into VR content? Welcome to New Theatre of the Mind, your VR 101 briefing from the Radio Festival. I'm Hattie Pearson from Key 103, and you might be wondering why I'm stood here, because I have never used a VR headset and I know nothing about VR. Hands up. So we'll be doing a bit of a Tomorrow's World-style live experiment shortly, and these three wonderful people are hopefully going to convince me that it's worth bothering about. So with me today is Nathan Newman, with a background in games and social media marketing. Nathan is now the CEO of Virtual Reality Associates, which is a startup in Manchester. So let's start by finding out what exactly is VR, Nathan.
Well, it's really simple. VR is all about presence, emotions, and directing the attention of your audience.
And how do we experience it? I know we've got something in front of me, which I'm very daunted by, but how can we experience it?
Well, there's lots of routes in, and I think there's a lot of naming problems in the industry right now, because people think AR and VR could be the same thing, and there's all these different definitions that the manufacturers are throwing out there. But at its core, you've got the sort of high-end headsets on one side of the market, where you buy a headset like the Oculus Rift or the HTC Vive for around £500 or £600, and then you connect that to a big gaming PC, which needs to be high-powered, and you have to spend thousands on it. At the other end of the market, there's the mobile headsets.
They look a bit cheap.
Yeah, they're a little bit flimsy. They're usually used for promotional purposes, so brands hand them out, or maybe at festivals you might find one under your seat.
And why is 2017 the big year for VR?
Well, I think in the media, everyone's been saying for the last 3 years, it's the year of VR, and where we're at right now is that we're kind of at this saturation point where there's a lot of headsets out there on the market, and there's pieces of content which are trending and going viral. There's a Gorillaz music video, which we have set up for you here, which came out about 6 weeks ago, and that trended, and within 3 or 4 hours, it had around 7.5 million views on YouTube. So there's a lot of momentum. Everything's heading in the right direction.
So this is a medium kind of range headset, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. So if you've got the high end and the low end, this is kind of in the middle. So you snap your mobile phone into this headset.
Okay, so should we give it a go? What are you going to... So I genuinely have never put on a VR headset, and I'm worried. Apparently, some people can feel a bit seasick, and I get really seasick, so I'm genuinely worried. If you're on the front row, just maybe steer back a bit. But let's give it a go. Yep. I'm going to watch the Gorillaz music video. If you've seen it in non-VR, then you might know kind of what to expect. Unfortunately, you're not going to be able to see it on the screen, so I'm going to have to be a really good radio presenter about it and describe what I can see.
Okay,
here goes.
So, headset first.
Oh, my gosh, I'm so nervous about this. Just don't let me fall off the stage, please.
Okay. So what can you see right now?
Okay, I can see he's got the record. He's taking the record off the shelf, and he's currently still.
Okay,
but
so I'm just going to put the
head... Oh, my God, I'm in a basement. I'm in a cellar. There's a pipe. Oh, God. That genuinely feels really close. Okay, you're going to press play?
Yep, just a sec. Hold still.
I'm scared.
So can you see a play button?
No, not yet.
Okay, just a sec.
Okay.
Can you see a play button?
Got the headphones on. Okay, there's a little dot in the middle of the screen.
Okay, so look at the play button.
Yeah.
And then it should play.
Just look at it.
Yeah.
Oh. I'm looking at it. Nothing's happening. It's still.
Look around until you can see a play button.
No play button.
Okay. One sec. How about now?
Oh, now I can see a play button. What do I have to do?
Okay. look, Look at the play button.
Yeah.
And then
oh my God, he's putting the record on my head. Okay, now I'm spinning round. And there's raspberries. I'm in like a milk cereal bowl and a guy with a golf. Oh my God, his skin is licking me. That's so weird. That's really creepy. Okay, this ceiling is like coming up. Oh, what's happened? Oh my God. Oh, there's an elephant. Oh, Jesus. No, it's like a dragon eating somebody on a bed. That is truly terrifying. And now he's twiddling his thumbs. Okay, I've got to get this off. Jesus. That is really creepy. That's genuinely really creepy. But I didn't feel seasick. But if you've never tried that, give it. That is really bizarre. I can't explain to you how immersed I felt in that. And as you turn your head, the sound. Yeah, it's bizarre. You're kind of like followed and you are fully immersed. Like no other experience, I suppose. Well, thank you, Nathan.
No problem.
For terrifying me. we've got time for some questions at the end, so we'll come back to you. But next, I'd like to introduce you to Arne Skuk. Arne is from DR, which is a Danish public broadcaster, and like us, a radio person. But she's also got a side of theatre and film, so the perfect person to lead DR's virtual reality offer. So she's here to tell us what she's learned.
Thank you. Yeah, we have been produced VR for the last couple of years. We have produced a lot about the Danish history. I'm kind of like trying to nudge. We've produced about the Danish history, different VR experiences, but I have also produced VR experience in current affairs, sports, and satire. And recently, actually just a couple of weeks ago, we launched DR. DR is kind of like the equivalent to BBC in Denmark, like the public broadcaster, just a little tinier. We have launched our first VR app in the two app stores, and you can watch it on either the more cardboard experiences or the better ones like you just did there. Right. I think every time you are on a stage, you have an obligation to either quote Elvis or Dolly. And this time I'll choose Elvis. And I'll choose him because back in 1971 in Vegas, this is a live recording, he actually forecasted what we could use VR for as journalists. So if you are listening very careful to the lyrics coming here in a short while, we don't need to tell you more about VR. This is kind of like he is telling about the perfect VR experience.
If I could be you, if you could be me, for just 1 hour. If we could find a way to get inside each other's mind. Oh, if you could see you through my eyes instead of your ego. I believe it'd be surprised to see that you've been blind. Oh, what am I in my shit? What am I in my shit? Yeah, before you abuse, criticize and accuse, why am I in my shoes?
This is what a VR experience is about. Letting other people try to see it from a different perspective. And I think it's what we often seek as journalists, to create a story so profound so you can feel deep down in your stomach how it is to be Elvis. Or a homeless, or a refugee, or a class teacher in a class with 25 potential troublemakers. I will give you an example how we try to embed the audience into the world of the story, how we try to create a deep understanding of our current issues by letting the audience experience the story in this present and immersive mode. We're dealing with a subject we have dealt with many times before in DR, domestic violence. And there was a new statistic showing there was a released showing a large increase in the number of domestic violence, in particular in the better off homes. And of course, everybody could agree this was bad, and we wanted to take it beyond this discussion. We wanted to move the audience perception to a different level. So we created a VR experience where we took the viewer into a home of a family with a violent father, and it was experienced through a first-person point of view. And this is how we record a first-person point of view, so it's actually seen by the boy in this home called Anton. And then we showed it to several people before an interview. And here, there's a Danish minister. John, can you change? Yep. And here we have the Danish minister, Inger Støjberg. I don't know if you know him from... she's been called by New York Times a Danish Trump fiend. She is a really tough cookie. And we showed her this this VR experience and interviewed her afterwards. And this is how the interview looked like.
Hvordan var det?
Det var ikke sjovt.
Nej, Peter, lad nu være. Peter, nu skal I starte begge to.
Altså, jeg synes, altså, det var... Altså, jeg er selvfølgelig det, så se det, men... Altså, den der måde, man så dækker over efterfølgende, synes jeg var helt valgt.
Ja. Hvis du havde været Anders, den her nabo, der stod og bankede på.
Hej, Anton.
Hej.
Hey.
Problemet er jo, at han gør, hvad han skal.
Ja.
Altså, han gør, hvad han kan, ikke?
Ja.
Altså, det er jo det, der er så forfærdeligt ved det. Altså, at han jo, han forsøger at gribe ind. Altså, jeg kunne slet ikke... Peters blik, der kunne jeg slet ikke... Altså... Jeg havde sådan en fornemmelse af, at jeg sådan fangede hans blik efterfølgende, altså farens blik, ikke?
Ja.
Og hvor man bare tænkte... Kæft, et dumt syn. Ja, for at sige det her. De to mennesker, som han stoler allermest på, formodentligt, står og dækker over, hvad der lige er foregået. Når man ser sådan noget som det her, og jeg er også godt klar over, det, at det foregår, så kan man jo bare være uendeligt taknemmelig for den barndom, man selv ved, ikke? Det er jo et kæmpe brist og et kæmpe svigt overfor et barn. Ikke? Sådan en dreng, han vil jo resten af sit liv, vil han jo være med det.
So when I showed it to our news people, they've said they've never ever had an interview with her where she's saying, so I don't know what to do about any problem. So this was a different starting point for an interview because she had this first person experience of being a child in a home with domestic violence. This was a part of a greater project in DR with a lot of radio shows. We showed it to several well-known persons in Denmark, and we also had articles on websites, films on YouTube, just roll on, John, articles on our own website, on YouTube, and you could feel that the VR experienced that it also took the discussions to a different level, and it was used by a professional dealing with the subject to actually get into the seat of the children. Roll on, John. Yep. So what does a VR experience, what can it do? It can embed the audience into the story. Actually, it can, what you said, it feels like you are present and you are either you feel like you are there and you are together with the people in the scene. So you embed the story into the story. It kind of like has a holistic understanding. It's an understanding that doesn't come from being told about the issue or the characters or the story. It's by experiences the story yourself. And of course, as everybody talks about in VR, it's an empathy machine. VR is a closer experience to real life than regular looking through a 2D screen. You feel immersed into the story, and it gives you at least an audio and visual feeling of being there. And of course, there's a lot of ethic questions in that in that sense as well. Yeah, John, would you take the last one? And we have, yep,
got.
And we just launched the VR app, and again, of course, you are lacking a lot of Danes having headsets. But then it also can become an outreach event where we bring a lot of headsets and get a lot of feedback. And it's very important because storytelling is still a new thing for us as radio people taking on producing in VR. So this about getting feedback all the time is very important. But I think from now on, we still have 2% of Danes having a real headset, and then we have all these Google cardboard headsets coming into the market as well.
Awesome. Thank you, Anna. And I'm sure from that footage itself, it's clear to see how impactful and how powerful using VR, which I had absolutely no idea until this session today, experiencing myself, how incredibly powerful it can be, and making one of Denmark's tough cookies feel a bit of emotion. Yeah. So now to join us from BBC Radio 4, we have Rhian Roberts, and they have dipped their well-pedicured toes into VR. Tell us all about Quake, which is...
I did my own toes.
Just okay, fine. Yeah. That wasn't on the BBC, you didn't sit there like...
So this is a couple of stills from Quake, and Quake was produced for us by BBC North, by a fantastic drama producer there called Sharon Sefton. And the reason I think it works is because, well, in my eyes it works, was because we started from the beginning with an idea and then built it up from a tech point of view and from a distribution point of view with the drama team. So it wasn't something that was added to as we went along. And Sharon had been looking for a while to find something that she could use to tell a sort of fragmented story. So this is about the aftermath of an earthquake, which I would imagine leads to a fragmented experience because lots of people experience it in different ways. So if you haven't seen it, it's 12 short apps around about 6 minutes each. And the idea is you can choose to listen to it in any order you like. We suggest there is an episode 1 and an episode 12, but you can take the journey however you want, trying to replicate the sort of post-disaster fragment what the hell is going on type experience. And in Ep 1, there's a VR experience that goes along with it. The rest of it is graphic novel, slow-moving visualization of the audio. So you can choose. You can have an episodic approach. You can have it as a podcast, 1 to 12. You can have it as a pick-and-choose podcast. You can have it as a drama all stitched together. And the idea was, if we're going to invest this sort of money in this sort of project, we have to make it as available as possible. We have to try as much as we can as we're doing it. We have to make something that's really focused at the right at the young end of the replenisher audience, as they're called in Radio 4 land. And let's take a punt. So that's Quake.
So you mentioned a bit about the audience there. To me, it feels a bit Radio 1, a bit of a younger audience. Why are Radio 4 doing it?
I don't really think about Radio 4 or actually most radio stations now in terms of an age demographic. I think of it more in terms of who's up for trying some new stuff. And if you're in digital, our job is to keep trying to present the radio station content on different platforms to people who are on those platforms. So I'm thinking what fits this platform rather than what fits this demographic. So we hope that a young audience will find it and may find a way in through the graphic novel type approach. Radio 4 audiences who are trying out podcasts will find it there. And so it's not really about does this look too young, it's does it look right for the platform.
Okay, so you mentioned again about the audience. How do you think it's perhaps a bit too early to be doing this considering there's so few VR consumers out there at the moment? Is it cost effective?
We did it in partnership. Sharon is a top woman, and she did this in partnership with the EBU. So I wouldn't normally say, let's spend a shed load of money on VR, but if we can partner with somebody else and it's useful for them to try and grow their organisation, it's useful for us to try and grow our audience and to experiment, which I absolutely think we have to do, then it's worthwhile. Also, if we're going to do something like this, I think we have to make it as available as possible. So I wouldn't just do a VR thing. I want to try and use it to check out all the other things we were trying to do at the same time. Have I answered the question?
Kind of, but there are too few consumers out there to make it worth its while that we're doing it.
I tell you, I had great fun with one consumer, Roger Bolton from Feedback. So I had a similar experience with Roger in a small room trying out VR, and it is the funniest thing I've done for quite some time. It was like, you know, experimenting with LSD in the 60s, watching Roger try.
So what was the feedback from the Radio 4 audience? What did they have to say about it?
Well, it didn't really please people who are traditional reviewers of drama, and that made me really happy, because it wasn't for a traditional consumer of the afternoon play. It's not made that way. It's trying to do something different. The thing that made me happy was getting emails from a woman who'd been in the Japanese earthquake, saying that she thought it was a good piece because it's about digital humanitarianism, this thing. And that sounds really dull, but it's not. So it's how can somebody on an iPad over here help somebody with Google Maps over here, find a man who's trapped here? And she liked the fact that it had explained how relief organisations and ordinary stories are told post that. And she'd found it a really useful thing. And I thought, yeah, those are the sort of people that I'm really pleased to get reviews from. And also, you know, on social, you do get younger people, because they're on social, coming back and saying, oh, I really like this, or I really like the pictures, or I, you know, and that feels like a job done to me.
So I've got 1 minute left. I'm going to one quick question, then I've got one quick question for Anna. For you, Rianne, for anyone in the room that wants to give it a try, perhaps on the network, what would your advice be?
Well, I think what Anna's shown is, you know, that's a great way into another person's world. And we're doing it with drama, you're doing it with factual. If you can take somebody to somewhere, God willing, they'd never get to, and show them that and help them to empathise. Because, a lot of those pulls into radio on new platforms as well, they're all about empathy, they're all about mood. And VR helps you recreate a mood. And I think that's what I would suggest.
In 20 seconds, why do you think radio people are specifically good at producing this kind of VR content?
Yeah, I'll pick on one that, because I think VR is basically either be them or be there. So either you'll transport people to a place they will never ever go themselves, or you have to try to be, you know, unlucky, a guy in a domestic violent home. So that's very, very important. And why are radio people so good? Because you have to skip all your television knowledge, because you have to do long takes. You have to do this, like, where you put the story. You don't do the story afterwards in the editing. You have to make the story while you're there. So it's kind of like the audience is kind of like doing their own framing. So you have to create these 360-degree scenes that they can investigate. And it's a lot more about, like, when you go out and do reportage, radio reportage or documentary, about creating these scenes people can investigate themselves.
Oh, and there's one other thing as well.
It's been flashing for a minute and a half. I'm having a nervous breakdown here.
Just for radio people, you use the soundscape to draw the head. Draw, so, you know, diddly diddly dee. Oh, what's happening over there? Yeah. Bang, crash, down there. Yeah. So you use your audio skills to guide your visuals. So it's a great new challenge for radio people to reinvent the way that we use audio with visuals. So,
perfect. Sorry. Thank you very much to our producer, John Ryan, Rianne Roberts, Anna Scott, Nathan Newman, and Matthew Fulton. Thank you.
Well done.